What's up, everyone? I hope you're doing fantastic tonight. This is Raphael Garcia here for episode number 109 of the Let's Talk Wrestling podcast. Today is Thursday, February 3rd, and boy, has it been a week. Not just necessarily in the wrestling space, but it's been a crazy long week. I'm exhausted. I don't know about the rest of you all, but I don't know if it's even we can blame COVID anymore. Things have just been hectic, and this has been a very long week for myself. But I'm here to give you another edition of this podcast where I'm talking about professional wrestling as usual. I want to thank everyone for taking the time to check out this show. You'll be able to find our content across multiple channels, including our flagship, which is MMAratings.net and .com. Our social media is MMAratingsNet in both spaces, Instagram and Twitter. And you can catch our podcast on YouTube at MMA Ratings. This and the MMA Ratings podcast, which is every Wednesday with myself and Shawn Hume. Our podcast is also across multiple other platforms, including Anchor, Breaker, Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts, Overcast, and Spotify. Me, you can check me out at rgarcia_sports on both Instagram and Twitter. Today, I'll be talking about Brian Kendrick and AEW. Also talking a little bit more about AEW shows, Shane McMahon and the Royal Rumble Fallout, a couple other items as well, too. So let's go ahead and hop into this. We'll be going probably about 30 minutes again, 30, 40 minutes at most, because your boy's exhausted. But I wanted to get the show up to keep the momentum going. We're seeing a lot of we're seeing some stronger engagement on our YouTube platform, so I want to thank everybody for taking the time to check us out there. Our Spotify could grow a little more, but we'll just have to keep putting out content until people begin to engage with it a little more. So yeah, in that vein, let's talk some wrestling. So obviously, probably the biggest story of the week is the situation with Brian Kendrick. And if you have not heard, let's give you a quick overview of that. Towards the end of last year, 2021, Brian Kendrick requested his release from WWE, and it kind of went under the radar. It wasn't necessarily announced that it was granted or if he was, if how close his contract was to ending, but he did request his release. If you remember, he was supposed to be in a match with Harland on NXT. You remember the segment where Harlan and Joe Gacy, basically Harlan threw him down the stairs, and that was supposed to result in a match, but it never occurred. It was supposedly because of COVID that it was taken off the air, or it never happened. But we then hear that Kendrick requested his release. So fast forward to this week, where Brian Kendrick is announced as being a part of AEW Dynamite. So he was announced on Tuesday. That's when the news broke that he was going to be on the show. He was going to have a match against Jon Moxley, which is a huge spot to be on a card. I mean, Kendrick is a very capable wrestler. If you know who, I mean, even just from his WWE run, but you can go all the way back to when he was spanking on the Independence and the work he was doing there. But, I mean, he is a multiple-time tag team champion in WWE, a former Cruiserweight champion. He was a pretty well-booked, well-pushed single star when him and Paul London broke up, and he had the I can't remember the big guy that he had with him, but yeah, he was pretty well booked at the time. So, and then he was a Cruiserweight champion when they brought the Cruiserweight title back. He had a strong run in a Cruiserweight Classic. His match with Kota Ibushi is still one of my favorites from that entire tournament. But unfortunately for Kendrick, I'm not gonna say unfortunately, maybe not unfortunately, stupidly of Kendrick, he has some ridiculous fucking controversial thoughts, and it's all wrapped up within conspiracy theories that are ridiculous. Like some as far as saying that Obama is a reptile human, or whatever the fuck that is, that we as humans are an experimental combination of reptiles and something else, that the earth is hollowed out, the moon is hollowed out. But the anti-Semitic comments he was making, and this is like up to 10 years ago, that he was making on video, clear as day, that is Kendrick talking about this stuff, came back to haunt him, because they came up this week and multiple people started pointing it out, like, hey, this is who you guys are bringing in. Now, it goes without saying that, yes, AEW was about to sign him almost a day after, like sign him and put him right into a match with Moxley. It wasn't necessarily say he got signed to a full-time contract, but he was definitely going to get booked for at least one night. But he was in WWE for the last 5 or 6 years. And this, like I said, this video content of him saying all this, and it's not just one, is almost a decade old. So people saw this. People knew about this. I mean, it's interesting because people looked at Paul London, and he separated himself from Brian Kendrick years ago, well before this. So it was clear as day that something was up with Brian Kendrick, but this really flew under the radar. I had never seen this content. As much as I've been watching pro wrestling for years, over the last like decade or so, as I've gotten more into the space of covering it professionally or in a freelance sense, I never even saw this stuff. So when it popped up to me on Wednesday, I was like, yo, what is this? So AEW responded, and they ended up pulling him from the card. He was replaced by Will Ayuda. So this is an interesting dynamic and breakdown here. The reason why is because, yes, they made the move to release or to kind of cut ties with Brian Kendrick immediately. Tony Khan released a statement that basically his comments and his actions are not welcome here in AEW. I'm not going to read the whole statement. But Brian Kendrick also released a statement, I'm not going to call it an apology, during AEW Dynamite as well, too, which basically tried to make it seem like he didn't know what he was saying or he didn't know those types of things were anti-Semitic, which is bullshit. But, you know, people don't apologize for messing up. They apologize for being caught, basically, and that's what he was doing. But AEW and WWE as well, I mean, they were ready and willing to bring this guy in, and that kind of says a lot to me from the AEW standpoint. They have, just like WWE, they have problematic individuals on the roster, individuals who have been accused of sexual assault and worse. If there's, I mean, can you say worse? But they've been accused of some ridiculous ass shit, and they're still there, still in prominent positions. So when they take a stance against something like this, you have to ask, well, what else should you be taking a stance about? There's always like, there's always a whataboutism, as people say. So this will be something to watch, but I doubt that we'll see Brian Kendrick pop up in any other situations, any other promotions soon. I'm sure he'll have to show some type of true apology, true remorse for his actions and his words. This is not cancel culture. This is simply somebody paying the consequences for shit that they've done. I mean, his statements were racist and anti-Semitic from the gate. And if you listen to what he's saying, it's no way you can mistakenly say those types of things and be like, oh, I didn't know. Like, come on, guy, you know better than that. So like I said, he's being held accountable for his actions. It's good to see AEW do that. It'll be interesting to see how they deal with that going forward as they look at who's on their roster, if they have to make a decision around who's on their roster and who they brought in. I mean, you saw a lot of people upset when they brought in Jay Lethal at Full Gear last year. People pointed out at the accusations against Darby Allin. So, I mean, what are you going to do with that? It'll be interesting to see if they do anything or if they make any statements. They won't, but you can't selectively punish people, or you can, but you'll still get some type of response from the public for that. So it'll be interesting to see how this kind of moves forward over the next months and years as AEW continues to develop and grow. I want to talk about AEW Dynamite from last night, and it's really the tale of two shows. The first match was Moxley and Yuta. That was a fine, great match. You know, go back and watch that when you have the opportunity. Watch the main event. MJF and CM Punk really delivered, and I'll be talking about that more in a second. But the middle part of the show was not good. I was okay. I enjoyed the women's match. Nyla Rose and Ruby Soho. A lot of people are trying to claim Ruby botched towards the end when she missed I think the runaway kick or something like that. But if you look at it, it's actually a callback to how Ruby beat Nyla Rose a few months ago, because she pulled her off the top rope and hit that kick. This time she went to do the same thing, and Nyla kept the top rope in her grip. Nobody really caught the nuance around that. So I didn't even catch that at first. I had to see it again today. So that was the good of the show. But the bad was really bad. Chris Jericho, get off my television. But the Dan Lambert, Brandi Rhodes segment was, what, 5-6 minutes? They could have given that. That could have been another women's match. Instead of saying, oh, it's a segment that included a focus around a woman. It was a older white man talking about cancel culture, talking about slapping the shit out of a woman, telling her that her original job was her being turned over face down, like talking about her chest, all like this shit isn't needed. It's not necessary. And we get to the Paige VanZant, Brandi Rhodes pull apart, but okay. And Paige has never wrestled before. I've never seen her truly show any interest in being a professional wrestler. Brandi isn't the greatest worker in the ring. I mean, they could have done Paige at Thunder Rosa. That's right there. Thunder Rosa's fought MMA. Paige has, you know, fought MMA, done bare knuckle brawling as well. They could have done that. They have Marina Shafir right there as well, too. She's fought. She's done MMA as well at a high level. They could have done that. I think she may have more fights than Paige. They could have did that. That was right. No, she doesn't. But that was right there. But no, we're going to go with Brandi and Paige VanZant with the Dan Lambert shtick in the background. Why? Like, that is my thing. Like, I haven't seen it. Like, every time I see Dan Lambert on television and I see the response to that, a lot of people are like, what are we doing here? Why is this guy still on TV? Why is he getting so many segments? He was in another segment later on in the day, later on in the evening as well, too. So when I look at that, it's like, why are we so tone deaf around that? Like, this is a serious blind spot where it's akin to what we see in WWE with Vince McMahon, where people are saying, hey, we don't, fans, viewers, people who are paying their money, saying and paying their time, we don't want to see this, but the creative leaders behind the scenes saying, no, you're going to see it because this is what we want to put in front of you. It's not even getting to the point where it's go away heat now. Like, this is the first time I'm actually going to sit here and talk about it, because I usually would tweet or write about this, and I'm not even doing that anymore because it's just it's too ridiculous. It's just too out of left field, and I don't want to give them that type of publicity any longer. It's stupid. We don't need to see it. It doesn't need to be on television. There's so many different ways that they could get this. I'm going to write a piece about Paige, though, because I do think she has the opportunity to bring some eyeballs to the product, especially if you know about her abilities as a influencer and drawing attention in that fashion. But Dan Lambert and Brandi Rhodes are just not, it's crazy to me. Brandi Rhodes has a three, if you were to put together a list of the top or the worst segments and promos in AEW history, Brandi Rhodes has three of them. Two with Dan Severn. Two with Dan Lambert, and then the one with Jade when she was, and then another thing, Dan Lambert brought up her code switching, which is stupid as hell for him to be the one to bring that up. I don't want to hear AEW make light of a situation like code switching when probably one of the most powerful black women in professional wrestling is doing it for heat. Period. She's code switching for heat, and she's the most powerful black woman in professional wrestling. I think we can easily say that. No one needs to see that. No one needs to be involved in that. And I'm 110% over. Like I said, that's not even go away heat now. So let's move on, because I want to talk about another point with AEW Dynamite and Rampage as well, too, that was being touted around on social media and something that I'm kind of agreeing with. So there's thought that Rampage and Dynamite are losing momentum, and that the shows haven't been as consistently good as they were last year or early in the pandemic in 2020. And I can agree with that. I've seen some point towards Kenny Omega's exit for his injuries as the point around that. And I can see that, because he does bring a different type. Like, he does bring a level up to the show, him and Elite. I mean, the Young Bucks weren't on the show last night either. So they do add a special type of push to the show. But overall, it has lessened over time. I think it was Paul Heyman, I believe, or maybe Mick Foley, one of the two, that talked about CM Punk's, the glow of CM Punk being back in wrestling will run out at some point. I don't think we're at that point yet, but I'm interested in seeing what it looks like when we do get there, because I think that's going to be something that they have to really cognizantly book around. Right now he's over. He can get in there and he can break dance and do the spin on Rooney and fans would cheer and lose their shit. But how long is that going to last? I think that that's an interesting question and something that we were having a conversation back and forth with Blake on Twitter today. Blake, what is Blake's last name? Let me see. I was having a back and forth today with Blake. I can't even say Blake's last name, but he is with Forbes Sports. And he used to be with Bleacher Report. But we were talking about whether or not this show is kind of losing steam. And one thing he pointed out two things. One that I really agree with, that the Lance Archer, Adam Page storyline around the AEW title isn't it for him. And I get that because I understand why Lance is in this position. He's in a spot that they want to give Page some wins as champion. So I get that. And this will be a feud that he wins. And if they have the match next week, it'll be a blow off and we'll move on from there. I think we have a little bit of time before we get to the Adam Page, Adam Cole storyline. I think that's where he loses the belt. I think Cole should be the one to take it from him because Hangman doesn't seem like he's going to keep his momentum long term. So I understand that. And he also pointed out that there seems to be just a lot. There's a lot happening on these shows, but none of it none of it has substance to make it a storyline that you continuously talk about. And that I can agree with. There are a lot of great matches going on AEW week in and week out, but very few of them are tied to in-depth storylines that make you want to continue to tune in. I'll give you a recent example. Hikaru Shida and Serena Deeb. That, the first match, we knew it was going to be a banger, but as they developed that storyline of those two women hating each other and damn near trying to kill each other, that was a reason to make sure I tuned in every time I saw one of their matches announced. So they don't have anything like that really going on right now. They have the MJF CM Punk Wardlow storyline, but what else do they really have outside of that? I don't care too much for Archer Page. I don't care too much for the Ass Boys with Jungle Express. I don't care too much. Jurassic Express, excuse me. I don't care too much about that. You have Jade. I will make it a point to watch all of Jade's matches, but she's not even really involved in an intricate storyline right now. So what do they really have that they're putting out there as this is a reason to not only want to come see the match, but to want to come see everything around that? And that's something that they've done very well up until this point, but right now it just seems like that is not consistent week into week out. And I noticed that Rampage is missable TV to me, but as I've mentioned on the show in the past before, Fridays is usually the night that I go out, and I am not going to force myself to sit down and watch SmackDown and Rampage. Like this weekend, I'll be out because that's my time. So even though they have some good matches booked, I think they have Ricky Starks and who's Ricky Starks having a match against? Goodness, it's for the FTW title, but that's going to be something worth watching. Jay Lethal, him and Jay Lethal are having a match too. So there's stuff there that I would want to go back and see, but just not right now. So there is an interesting conversation on whether or not Rampage and Dynamite are losing steam, or if they're kind of having growing pains. That's a good way of putting it. That is, they're going up and down. So that's something to keep your eye on over the next few weeks. So I'm going to switch tune, talk about some WWE from this week. And there's a couple of things to talk about. Their earnings report was today. Jesse just put together a piece about that. And 2021 was a record-breaking year for them from a revenue standpoint. They talked about some of the opportunities that they had going forward, that they have planned going forward. I'm interested in seeing what the video game does when it comes out in probably about 4 weeks from now or so on the 13th of March. One interesting thing in their report that stood out to me is that they cited COVID-19 as a reason why there were so many roster cuts last year when, as they were making the cuts, they spoke about it from a budget cut standpoint, as if they needed to cut money for the budget, to make budget. From a marketing standpoint, I know that, and from a business standpoint, I know that that's some shit. Because even if they kept everyone that they had on the roster and backstage, they still would have had a record-breaking year. Wouldn't have been as big of a record-breaking year, but it would have been a record-breaking year. So it's unfortunate to kind of see that. But it's business. Like, that's how they want to play the game. They talked about the NIL program a little bit. Stephanie talked about that. She even talked about the metaverse, which is a buzzword. That's probably the biggest buzzword I've ever heard, the way people are throwing it around, and know that NFTs, because no one knows what the hell they really are and how to really leverage them right now. So, but they claim that they're going to be involved with the metaverse, which I probably expect. I'm still surprised that they haven't fully embraced VR seating for events, because that's something I would definitely be interested in. But that's another conversation for another day. But someone who was not present or mentioned at the earnings call today, Shane McMahon. Shane McMahon is another person that's been the talking point of social media this week, because Shane McMahon is out of the WWE. Ringside News reported it first. I wrote about it, I think, yesterday, that he was the focal point of frustration around the Men's Royal Rumble. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean he was blamed for it, as if it was his fault. He may be getting blamed for it, but it seems like they just need a fall guy for just how bad that show was. If you remember, Shane was one of the last five in there going toe-to-toe with Matt Riddle. He was supposed to be booking himself into a position to have matches with Seth Rollins in the near future, which is fucking ridiculous. It's funny because a lot of people were excited about Shane being back. And I was like, why? Like, he's a 52-year-old man. There's so many people in the back that we could take the time that he's going to take from them and allow them to shine on TV. I mean, Ali wasn't in the Rumble. Shelton Benjamin wasn't in the Rumble. Cesaro wasn't in the Rumble. There's so many people that just weren't. Cedric Alexander just weren't in it, that have the opportunity to be something bigger than they are. But instead, we want to give time to Shane. He's not the whole problem, but that type of stuff, I mean, like, I'm over it. We don't need to see, like, WWE continues to go back to the well with their old individual, their old stars, their old draws, thinking that they can still put asses in seats. And it's not working anymore. I mean, you can't even get people to sit down and watch on TV on a weekly basis. So what do you think that that's going to do with people coming to shows? I mean, I'm not going to go to a – I'm not going to buy tickets for a WWE event anytime soon, period. Unless if it's like – I do want to go to a Royal Rumble at some point. But outside of that, I'm not buying tickets to any WWE shows, just because you know what you're going to get. You watch Raw, you might get 3 matches, 4 matches in 3 hours. No, sorry. Same thing with SmackDown. You might get 2-3 matches in 2 hours. No, and I'm definitely not going to a NXT. That's a whole other conversation on another day. So why are we wasting time? Why are we wasting effort in hyping up Shane? During the investors call today, they hyped up Big E and Sasha Banks, all their work that they do outside of WWE, with Sasha being featured in the commercial for the national title game, and Big E walking out. Spencer Crawford Earl Spence and whatever that boxing fight was, I can't remember the two guys' names, but he was involved in that. But they treat him like shit when they're on TV. I mean, Big E was in the Rumble for 6 minutes before he just tossed over the top. He lost the title, gets pinned twice. Like, he loses the title, gets pinned in a match, and then gets pinned in the number one contenders match after that. And he's just shipped over to SmackDown and he's feuding with Baron Corbin and Madcap Moss. Seems like quite the demotion to me, but they hyped him up in the call. But hey, let's dedicate more time to Shane McMahon when we can't get Oscar back on television. We can't get like suitable women's matches on TV if you're not one of the four horsewomen. Like, what are we doing here? But it's interesting seeing how he's the fall guy for that whole situation. And that'll be a story to watch. I mean, he'll probably be back at some point in time. Remember, Shane went away for the better part of a decade and came back to a big push, but he doesn't need to be wrestling anymore. I'm sorry. Like, let's get that version of Shane McMahon out of the way. What's next? Royal Rumble fallout. Man, Royal Rumble sucked. The matches. Ronda and Brock winning. That does not make me want to watch WrestleMania or any of the shows leading up to it. Ronda, she's not good for the women's division. I mean, she might pull in some eyeballs. I haven't heard anything about ratings from this past Monday. She might pull in eyeballs, but just like the last time, she came in, she squashed everybody and left. And WWE was like, well, we don't have to book you guys effectively any longer. And they haven't done so since. Brock doesn't need a Royal Rumble win to be the number one contender. He can force his way into that. They can have him beat some people, surprisingly, and get his way into that picture too as well. But not only is he the Royal Rumble winner, but he's also in the Elimination Chamber in Saudi Arabia. So I wrote about this on the site this week too, but they booked Bobby Lashley into such a corner where how are they going to eliminate Lesnar at the Elimination Chamber? The only way I see it happening is if all other five guys jump him. And all five guys usually don't last through to the very end. We'll see. I mean, this could be a first time. I'm not going to watch it live just because the show's in Saudi Arabia. But I do have questions on how does Lashley come out of that event with the title? So let's say he doesn't, and they put it back on Lesnar so they can get back to this title for title situation. What was the point of putting it on Lashley then? That is another situation. I mean, it's crazy as hell. I didn't know this stat, but Brock Lesnar has ended the WWE Championship reign of every black person to hold that belt. Think about that. Big E, Kofi, The Rock, and if he beats Lashley as well too. That's ridiculous. And it lets you exactly know what the WWE thinks of that tier of talent or where they place those individuals. I mean, who's beaten Lesnar? Seth and Seth Goldberg beat him recently. And no, Goldberg didn't beat him. Seth and Roman. Like, that's it. Like, I'm okay with that. I'm okay with us getting that out of our system and figuring out a way to, they can keep the Roman Lesnar match for WrestleMania, but we don't need it to be title for title. There's another way we can do this. There are so many different ways that we can work Lashley into something. I really think we're headed for a situation where we have two rematches to headline WrestleMania. One will be Ronda versus Charlotte versus Becky again. The other will be Seth versus Lesnar versus Roman. I mean, that'll be something if they try to put those two matches. I could totally see them putting those two matches as the main event for night one and night two. Would they be, I mean, yes, they would draw a lot of attention. A lot of people talk about them, but again, nothing new. Back to the well, back to the same people, nothing new. And that would be unfortunate. It would be unfortunate for the people in the back who aren't being leveraged, right? It'd be unfortunate for fans who want to see something different, and WWE is adamant in not doing so. The last topic for WWE I want to talk about is the Free Ali movement. So as you guys know, Mustafa Ali requested his release. I talked about that last week. And he has been denied of such, which I get it. I don't agree with it, but I get it. The reason being is because WWE sees his value and they know that he's valuable to them, which means he's more valuable to another promotion. Ali can perform. He looks the part. He can speak the part well. He has a backstory people would be interested in. I'm sure he has some ideas in his mind that would blow this game out the water, blow a lot of shit out of the water that people are doing in other promotions and make people want to see. I would, wherever he performs, I would make it a point to watch. But WWE sees that and they're like, no, let's keep him under contract and let's wait him out. According to Fightful Select, he has at least a year left on his deal. So it'll be interesting to see if the Free Ali movement is still going once that year comes and goes. People are going to have to make a concerted effort to keep it going. I do not think they're going to release him. They were doing releases around financial calls around the end of quarter, so it would have happened like this week or so, and it did not. It's funny, as I said that, I went to go check Twitter just to make sure it hadn't happened while I'm talking about it. But I don't see them releasing him any point in time because they don't want him to go anywhere. And this isn't just about going to AEW. They know he would have an impact wherever he would go. They've seen his work. They're familiar with him as a pro wrestler, as a character, as a personality, as a professional. They know he would be a rock star wherever he goes. So instead of allowing him to do that, they're going to wait him out from a business standpoint. I get it. It's unfortunate that that's what they're going to do to him. Their practices, and it sucks because they have zero real superstars on our roster right now. Maybe two who are full-timers, Seth and Roman, and Sasha, excuse me, in my opinion. I mean, Becky as well, too. So that's four. Because if you watched the men, especially the men's Royal Rumble, the reactions of people coming out was like, whatever. The final four, I mean, I don't even remember who the final four are, but I know Bad Bunny and the final five, at least, Shane and Bad Bunny were part of that. Like, really? This is who we're getting to? Drew and Lesnar was a part of that as well, too. I don't remember who the fifth was. But this is what we're getting. This is what we're being fed. So you see a situation with Ali and you want him to be released. I get it. But you're going to have to keep that momentum up for an extended period of time because I don't believe they're going to release him anytime soon. And when he does get the opportunity to go somewhere else, fans are going to have to make it a point to follow him because if you don't, all of this voicing and all this concern will definitely be performative at best. So let's make sure that he still gets that support that we want to see him get and that he has the opportunity to shine in another capacity in some way, shape, or form, even if it's not professional wrestling. So let's move on to my other news section. Let's talk about a big women's match that was announced. So on the 2nd, yesterday, was the day that a bunch of non-compete clauses ended. Karrion Kross, Keith Lee, Mia Yim, and Ember Moon were the big names on that group. There were others as well, like Oni Lorcan. Lindsay Dorado is someone I was interested in. Grand Man Elite, I think that was the entire group. So right after that, I mean, hours later, Thunder Rosa announces that she and Ember Moon are now, I mean, going by her original name of Athena, are having a match at Warrior Wrestling 19 for the Warrior Wrestling Women's title that Thunder Rosa currently carries. That's going to be a banger. That is on the 19th, I believe. The 12th, excuse me, next Saturday. That is the 12th of February, so that'll be something worth watching. And I also want to hit on another news piece as Terminus continues to grow. I want to look at who they have announced so far. Let me get over back to their social media handle and pull this up because I do not remember the full group off the top of my head. But they have announced so far Killer Kate. I'm not too sure who that is, but she was added to the card. Let me see who else. Kenny Alfonso was added. Daniel Garcia, of course. Davey Richards was added. Let's see. Trey Maher was added. Serena D, she's a big one. She was announced last week. Queen Amita was added. Leon Ruff. Leo Rush was supposed to be there, but he's now injured. Kevin Blackwood's coming back. Swerve will be there too as well. So there's a lot to kind of look forward to on this card. They announced that their front row seats have already sold out. So that is for, I think that's a Thursday in Atlanta. And it'll be available probably on Fight TV again. We'll see how that goes. But that's another independent product that I intend on being a little bit more active with supporting. So if you do get the opportunity to watch that show or you get the opportunity to support them, feel free to do so. But with that in mind, we're going to go ahead and close out this show. I want to thank you, everyone, for taking the time to check us out. As always, you can check us out at MMAratings.net.com. You can hit us up across multiple social media platforms at MMAratingsNet and also across all podcast platforms, MMAratingsNet, in all those spaces and on YouTube as well. So just check us out at MMAratings myself. You can hit me up at rgarcia_sports. So with that in mind, we're going to go ahead and close out. Thank you, everyone, for your support. Please be safe. Enjoy the rest of your week and stay, try to stay COVID-free. Have a good one, folks.